that's better. So like, I come from a media studies background. My specialisation is in television. What I want to do with the next 12 to 15 minutes is literally launch a project that I'm now working on. Because of my work at MIT, I'm being pushed more and more into this interface with the games industry. And that's really, really interesting because I never really considered myself a gamer, but I'm reminded more and more about how I play video games. So what I'd like to do is to talk somewhat about that interface between being a gamer and playing video games, but also to talk about the idea of the video game itself. I wanted to twist things around, and the question I'm working with is the question about what is a game in, because I'm fundamentally interested in the console itself and the console as an object. And so I put up these two pictures because these two pictures, for me, bear out some of the useful tensions that I'm finding when we think about what a game is actually in. And on the right, we have the Xbox 360 as it appeared at some Xbox launch event, right? And it's lovely because that, as far as I'm concerned, is a beautiful object. And you know it's a beautiful object because it's lit by nice little LEDs and it looks like frickin' science. We're going to talk a lot about frickin' science because I really, really like frickin' science. On the left-hand side, what we actually have is where the Xbox 360 really, really lives. This is a blurry camera phone picture of someone's Xbox 360 tucked into their little entertainment system at home. And if you can, have I got a little mouse? Yeah, so you can see they've got this badass looking speaker. And this is, they've got an Xbox 360 Elite, which is interesting unto itself. But tucked all the way down here is a Dreamcast. And this, I have no idea what, that's a little camera flash. But this is a something else, I'm not quite sure what it is. This is a list of titles, and there is their controller, and down here is the Wii, and there's another game thing in here, and this is for talking to their friends, and this is their big telly, and this is a remote, and this is a guitar for Guitar Hero. And so this living room setup is it's the difference between, you know, the console as a scientific object, as freaking science, and the living room environment where it's actually experienced, that I find most interesting. And I'm coming to this because video games are a multiplicitous form. As a medium, if we start to think about them as a medium, they are oversignified. They are overflowing with things that we can think about and talk about. And this is particularly interesting because this is, of course, the reappropriation of the Wii's safety manual. I'm going to speak incredibly quickly. It's a cultural thing, I'm sorry. But I have an accent, so if you can't follow, just listen to the lilting tones. what I find so interesting about this, and why I think actually studying video game consoles as an object is useful, is that it tells us something about the way that we're currently interacting with technology. And that's one of the most substantial changes that has taken place in the last 25 years, is that people have become, at a domestic and at a home level, much, much more happy to interact with technologies. And I've spoken at a previous event about the way that our engagement with technology is particularly visceral. And we see this metaphor of viscerality again as we see Jason Chen stuffing another beautiful object down his pants. And personally, I think the notion of putting a game console down your trousers because you're so impressed with it is actually where game consoles need to be positioned. They are tactile objects. And I say this because when I'm interested in video games and the impact that video games have on their audiences, I actually don't give a shit about violence. I'm not particularly concerned about pathologizing the audience, but this is fundamentally an argument about the audience. And there's the audience having a fun time. What I'm interested in is not the impact that video game content might have on the audience, but I'm much more interested in the way that video games may impact audienceship. So this is me enjoying Wii bowling, well, not, I might have had a couple of beers. This is a mode of audienceship. And what's most interesting about the Wii controller is not its, you know, wand-like nature, but the fact that it allows us to perform audienceship in a new way. No longer are we sat on the couch, and this is just audienceship for video games in a new way. And the other thing that interests me is that at the moment we're coming to a point culturally where the video game console is a fetish object. The video game console has been around for long enough now that there are a bunch of us who remember them nostalgically from when we were kids, but also have enough money to buy them only for ourselves. And so it moves out of the family domain, it moves out of being a kid's toy, and instead it becomes something that you're allowed to like. And once you're allowed to like it, the way that we understand it, and particularly the way we understand it in the domestic space, changes. And I believe that it has an impact also on the domestic space. So what I want to talk about is this thing that I'm referring to as tactile virtue. This idea of studying objects in domestic spaces, is one that's been done for a long time in television. My mentor, John Hartley, who's a boisterous old man that a lot of people don't like, did this study many, many years ago where he got people to send in photographs of their television. So photographs of themselves with their TVs. But what he was asking specifically for was not necessarily photographs of their TV, but just photographs of the lounge room that happened to feature a television. And here what unfolds are a whole range of different strategies for understanding the relationship between the television as an object, and television as a cultural experience kind of thing, if you like. And so lastly, Anna McCarthy, who's done this by looking at TVs in migrant workplaces particularly. So how does a TV function in a Pakistani, in the shop owned by someone from Pakistan, as a way to negotiate transnational identity? Because screening on the television, which is up above the fryer that they're working at, might be something that's either domestically produced or is foreign. But the television set and the television image is located within a broader series of discourses, because around the TV set you get calendars and icons and all this other kind of stuff. And it's that kind of embeddedness, the TV set, the video game console, in everyday life, and the way that it's juxtapositioned with other elements in the lounge room, that I find really interesting. Because then we can move away from discussions about the impact that this technology may have on the audience that have traditionally followed this kind of route. We can now talk about the impact of video games without having to bother to address questions of whether making a Counter-Strike map is terrorism. And so these are some of the instances from TV studies that I'm interested in kind of appropriating. And these are all shots from Anna McCarthy's study on the way that the television functions to negotiate a transnational identity for migrant workers. So here we have, she finds particularly important, is the combination of the TV and the fridge, which is done for purely pragmatic reasons. But the juxtaposition of the two offer questions about cultural labour. Here we have the TV tucked amongst a range of other icons. This is in the back of his shop. And the role that television plays, again, talks about the kind of identity formation processes that the television object itself enables and informs. And this is the same in the body. And I think we see this also when we start to think about the video game console. And I want to focus just for a minute on the Nintendo, partly because on the right we have the Super Famicom. Now, what was the Super Famicom? Damn it, it was a family computer. And so in Japan, the video game console, when it first entered the kind of home domain, was positioned as it was a computer. It had connectivity, it was for computing things. When it gets to the US, of course, what's it renamed? Well, it's the Nintendo Entertainment System. So right now we have it disconnected or decoupled from specific discourses about computing and computation, and instead re-embedded in an entertainment and a leisure-style discourse. And this is particularly interesting because if we think about if we go one step earlier, and this is an iteration before the NES made it big, this is the Telstar Arcade, what we see at the top is an emphasis on the freaking science. This is a freaking microprocessor that's being put into your house, right? I mean, granted, you're going to play Wii Tennis. It's a freaking microprocessor. Whereas by the time we get to the NES, it's an entertainment system. And that distinction is one that actually characterized, I believe, relations in the US and certainly back home in Australia with the video game console throughout the 1980s. And then we get to this wonderful period that comes about 1984 and 1985, where the video game console moved away from being a children's toy. Because if we think about the Nintendo Entertainment System, it was like the Sega and to a certain extent like the Dreamcast, really. These were entertainment toys. These were for kids that were wrapped up within these implication-free discourses of leisure and spending time. Of course, they were significant for the television industry because for the first time, realistically, you had something you could do that meant you weren't watching television, but you were required to own a television set. So the NES decoupled